lovely song. It was wonderfully done. Lord knew what he was doing when he gave you a sore throat. That was a blessing for us all. Not that you wouldn't have been ringing. But it was really wonderful to have kids sing. Thank you so much. Better get this working here. That scripture reading was so beautiful, I want to read it one more time. Is that all right? You remember what it says in 1 Chronicles 29:11? It says, "Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. Everything in the heavens and on the earth is yours, O Lord. And this is your kingdom. We adore you as the one who is over all things." Isn't that powerful? Do we not have a wonderful God? But as we've heard, as we, you know, if you've been listening to the prayer requests and the comments, if you were here for the Bible study this morning lesson, you may have picked up a thread of a number of things that have happened to people. That there have been problems in lives. Things have happened. Things haven't always been the best for everybody. And today I want to talk about crisis. Crisis, you know, began in heaven. That's where it all began. When the perfect harmony was torn apart by the introduction of conceit and selfishness that is so clearly spoken of in the words of Isaiah as we hear of Lucifer and what happened in the beautiful surroundings of heaven. As it says in Isaiah 14, 13 and 14, "For you have said in your heart, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will be like the Most High." And with those kinds of words entered crisis. I really don't believe there was such a thing in heaven or anywhere until those words were spoken. And that crisis, the concept of crisis, followed Lucifer down from heaven to earth and has been around on this earth ever since. Throughout it all, crisis has worn the same attributes of Lucifer. The attributes of fear and of doubt and of uncertainty. And they've worn it with pride, just as Lucifer did. As he so boldly said, remember in the book of Job when God asked him, "Why are you wandering around here with us?" And he said, "Well, I just came from wandering back and forth across the earth." He said it twice. He was so proud of himself that he had a kingdom here on earth. Because he is the focus of crisis. And he is the focus of this earth in crisis. Throughout all crisis, we find that there has been no period in history, no individual who has ever lived on this earth that has ever been exempt from that concept of crisis. Now, I'm not talking about just troubles. We all have troubles. But I know that each one of us also can think of a time when troubles turn to crisis. Crisis comes to us all, and although the extent of the crises may appear greater for some, more so than for others, when crisis hits your life, it's big. And it is personal. And it takes away thought of all other things that have happened before and that are happening around you at present. Crisis is big, and crisis is personal. And this morning I want to look at a particular crisis that took place on a calm sea. Familiar sailors on a boat. They knew what they were doing. They were sailing across, as they had been asked to, this sea. But a storm began to arise. A crisis began to arise. With a violent increase in the tumultuous winds and the slashing of rain, and the moon was hidden behind the clouds, the dark and swirling low-hung clouds, and those of that little boat had begun to recognize that the little troubles they were having, the difficulties of life, had now begun to show that a crisis was soon to occur. Something was happening that they felt they may not be able to handle anymore. Have you ever been in that situation? Has life ever come at you and you could see it happening, but suddenly things have gotten so strong you just don't know whether you can handle it? You see, they have sailed this sea before. There are a number of them who are good sailors. They've had many difficult and rough sailings, but this one is different. This one is no longer just a rough trip. Their day is no longer just a bad day. This trip has become a crisis, and it has brought fear and doubt and uncertainty into their lives. The story is told in three of the Gospels, and I'd ask you to turn in your Bibles to Mark 6. That is the book that I'll be using today. The disciples have gone ahead of Jesus. They've gone ahead in their boat and they are facing this crisis. They are experienced and hard-working men, and they have been working hard to maintain the equilibrium of this boat. But they are beginning to realize it's a losing battle and they can do no more. And the fear that they feel is on the verge of turning to panic. Doubt has almost given over to despair, and uncertainty has begun to paralyze the minds of the terrified crew. I ask you again, has anybody ever been in this situation? When things happen too fast and with too great a power in our lives, sometimes you can feel paralyzed. Sometimes you just don't know what to do anymore. And it seems like it's black and nothing but. You see, life has been getting good for these guys. They've come from a bright spot, really. Things have been going well, looking up with this fellow Jesus that they have been following. He has captivated the masses. And they believed that soon he would declare himself king. In fact, they would have done that just earlier that day. But for some strange reason, Jesus said, hold on, hurried them away, and refused to let them join with the crowd who wanted to declare him king. And then it had gone from bad to worse. As they made their way down to the boat, and Ellen White tells us, they waited around and they talked about it and they questioned why he had done this and whose fault it was and what was going on that was not good. They were suffering from disappointment. They were suffering from despair, and they were now in a storm. And on top of that, they began to see above the waves a fearful apparition that had suddenly appeared. Surely they felt this was the end of it all. This was the crisis that they had feared for a long, long time. With the sting of the rain in their faces, the disciples searched the horizon in the direction that one of them had pointed, and there they saw an apparition. Despite the wind and the rain fiercely pelting down upon them, their eyes became wide as they looked and saw this apparition walking on the water. And if we are in the book of Mark, in chapter 6, in verse 49, you can read with me. And when they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed it was a ghost, and they cried out, for they all saw him, and they were troubled. They were terrified, other versions of the Bible say. If you've experienced crisis in your life, you know that a crisis can do many things to you. One is it can terrify you, because we are terrified of the unknown. We are terrified of what will happen when we don't have control. The fear, the doubt, the uncertainty, they pound you until all you begin to feel is panic, despair, and paralysis, leaving you bereft of all ability to reason. Whether it's the catastrophic loss of a home, of a job, or of a life, or perhaps dealing with the problematic issues of a family member, one that you love so much and you just can't get through to. Somehow the walls of separation have been built and you can't seem to scale them. Crisis in our lives can leave us terrified. And as we look at the future and see an end deeply shadowed by the crisis before us, we lose hope. This morning we talk in study about hope, and hope being the substance of our love and belief in Christ. That's where it all comes from. Here the disciples cried out because they were terrified of what they saw, and it all seemed lost. I've been in places like this. You very likely have been in a place like this, when the shadows are so tall and so dark that you can't seem to see anything but bad. If you can relate, then the next verse in this chapter is an important one to read and to remember. Because in verse 51, it says, immediately he talked to them and said to them, "Be of good cheer, it is I, do not be afraid." And then he went up into the boat to them, and the wind ceased. When did the crisis end for these men? You know, in my reading of this story so many times, I always thought it was when he got into the boat and the wind ceased. And as I was reading it this time, I see it differently. I see it differently. Did you note how Jesus spoke to them, by the way? He didn't call to them and yell at them or give them directions or do the things that normally we would do when we have a crisis. Throw up our hands and try to do things physically or in any way. All Jesus said is, "It is I." That's all he said. And that was enough to end the crisis. That was the moment the crisis ended. When he said, "It is I." Why do I believe that? Because these men knew Jesus. The crisis that had held their attentions may have caused them to forget him at the time. But they had lived with Jesus. They had traveled with him. They had eaten with him, laughed with him, cried with him, worked with him. They had seen him heal the needy and feed the masses. They were witnesses to the miracles granted through the power of God. They had been awed by his love, awed by his compassion, his humility, and the concern for each and every human being he came in contact with. They knew his divinity as well as his humanity. And because of that experience, because they knew Jesus, they knew when he identified himself to them that they were safe in the midst of a storm. My Bible says he climbed into the boat with them and the wind died down. But it was before the wind died down that a calm came to their hearts. The wind that just moments before had almost torn the clothes from their bodies was suddenly still. The waves that just moments before had rolled and pitched about them, blocking out their view of the horizon and threatening to capsize the boat, suddenly those waves were calm. Peace is restored to the sea and to the little boat upon it. But peace was restored to their hearts when they recognized Jesus. Most speak of the taming of the sea as when the crisis ended. But as I have said, it is my belief that the crisis ended when Jesus, before he calmed the wind and the sea. Because when you think about crisis, in reality, the crisis isn't the event. The crisis isn't all of the things that are happening around you that swirl about us when we are so troubled. The crisis is the trouble in our hearts. It's not what is going on around us. It is what is in our hearts. The crisis for these men was that they had lost sight of Jesus and become absorbed in themselves. The crisis began before they even set foot in that boat. The crisis began when they came down from the mountain and started to rumble and grumble and moan about Jesus not doing what they wanted him to do. And who was going to be on the right hand, and who was going to be on the left hand, and why it was taking so long, and all of the things that they were thinking about. The crisis began when they forgot about Jesus, and it ended when they recognized Jesus was with them, and they remembered who he was. Jesus had been with them all of the time. But when they recognized he was there, when they remembered who Jesus really is, then the crisis ended in their hearts. As soon as the disciples knew they were in the presence of Jesus, the storm died down, not around them. In a crisis, storm can continue, but the crisis can be dealt with. The crisis can disappear. It wasn't the storm and the wind and the waves that disappeared when they recognized Jesus. The storm in their hearts and their minds was put to rest. Peace was restored to the hearts and minds of the disciples as soon as they recognized Jesus. Because Jesus was there and they knew who he was. He was God. I have to ask you, do you know Jesus? Do you know of his power? Do you know of his love for you? His sacrifice? Do you know of his promises and the preparations he has made to bring you home? Peace came to the hearts of the men in the boat as soon as they recognized who was out there on the water in the storm with them, because they recognized him and they knew him well. Do you know Jesus? And do you know him well? Do you spend time with him each and every day? That's the only way to really get to know him and to know his love for you, to recognize the power he has, to see the example of the creative power, the sustaining power that Jesus has in our lives. The only way you will recognize him, especially in the midst of a storm, when troubles are swirling around and are on the way up to reach the point of crisis, the only way you will recognize Jesus is if you truly know him by being with him daily. When they recognized Jesus was with him, the crisis passed. And when they took him into the boat, then all the signs of trouble went away. Remember Peter? He got out of the boat. In Matthew, it talks about that. And he came to Jesus, walking on the water. Why did he fall? Because he saw that the waves still were tumultuous. The storm was going on. But Peter had the peace in his heart to recognize that Jesus was Lord. And if he said, come, I'm coming. He had peace in his heart in the midst of that crisis. Because you don't have an end to a storm doesn't mean that Jesus isn't still with you. You don't have to carry it on through crisis. Crisis is different. Crisis when you lose all thought, all way of finding a way out. You need to come to Jesus first. Benjamin Franklin, the American, said something like this. He said, there are only two things certain in life, death and taxes. Yeah. And that's true. It's true. There are two things that are certain. Death and taxes happen. But I hate to disagree with a famous man, but I know that at least two other things are true. Number one, crisis will find us in our lifetime. You have gone through it, perhaps. Those of us who are older have gone through it more often. Those with children have gone through of it more often than that. Crisis is going to find you. Life may be very good. It was great for the disciples for a while. But crisis found them. That's number one. The second thing I want to add is that Jesus can cause the storm of crisis to end. Crisis will find you, but with Jesus it is possible to avoid your ship sinking in that storm when it arrives. It's possible to ride out the storm and arrive safely at the other side. The secret is to know Jesus well enough that you can recognize who he is in the midst of the storm. When they looked out through those dark clouds and that driving rain, they saw an apparition. They thought it was a ghost. That's something they would run from. But it was Jesus. We need to be able to recognize Jesus in our stormy times. 1 Chronicles, once again, 29:11. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. Everything in the heavens and on the earth is yours, O Lord, and this is your kingdom. We adore you as the one who is over all things. That is our God. He is the one in control. Even in our crises. Proverbs gives us some advice in Proverbs 3, 5, 6, where it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all ways acknowledging him, and he will make your path straight. God is in control. In this world that values self-reliance, and we do, as a primary importance, I have to show I can do it. It would seem contradictory to give up control to someone else, especially in a time of trial. But that is what we need to do. We need to give it up to Jesus. He's not asking you to give up your ability to plan or to think or to act. That would be foolish. He gave us the gift of reason for a reason. But the proverb reminds us that there are situations we face in life, crises, which our own understanding seems far too frail to deal with. And that's when we most need to start trusting in God. Our own understanding won't do it. We need the assurance that he is in control of our lives. And that even though we may see hard times, we may suffer through hard times, our ultimate destiny is safe with him. With that knowledge, the early Christians went to the stake, knowing that even if they lost their lives, God was with them. With the knowledge that Jesus was with them and he is the powerful one in our lives, Jesus went to the cross, knowing that his suffering was all part of a greater plan, that with its fulfillment came the peace and joy and unification with God. God's word never promises that we won't suffer in the midst of crisis. He promises that when we trust him enough to leave him in control, he will still the storm and bring us an everlasting peace and joy. In John 16, verse 33, Jesus says, in this world, we will have troubles. But he says what? Take heart. Why? Because I have overcome the world. We have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear. Even in the midst of crisis, if we know Jesus. If we do, if we know Jesus, we know we can trust him. Even in crisis, especially, in crisis. Don't lose sight of that truth. He is in control. Let excuse me. Let him handle it. One thing that I do far too often is handle it. Is handle it. Far too often it fails. If we try to do it in crisis, we might fail. Far worse. My prayer today is that you continue to get to know Jesus. Get to know him by reading your Bible. Get to know him by spending time on your knees in prayer with him. Get to know him by getting together with others of like mind. Get to know him by turning aside from the radio and the music and the television and the things that take us away from God and spending more time with him. Because if we do not recognize Jesus in times of trouble, we won't recognize him in crisis. Our eyes will be blinded and it will be too late. And crisis is coming for everyone in this world. We need to prepare today. When we give him control of our lives, he offers us a shelter from the storms of life and the crises of life. Let's sing our closing song, number 528, to shelter in a time of storm.